Okay, so thanks to the organizer for the opportunity to give a talk here. So as you can see, I will not be talking about resonances, actually. I will rather be speaking about eigenfunctions, but in a non-compact setting. So I would like to start by a refresher on plane waves, what people call distorted plane waves. And of course, you can start with the Euclidean setting. And in the Euclidean setting, we all know what a plane wave is. And the point is, plane waves are a way to parameterize the continuous spectrum of the Laplacian. That's the way we see it. And if you use Fourier transform, you see actually that you can decompose any compactly supported function into a continuous sum of plane waves. And this is not just only for the case of the Euclidean space. It also works for the hyperbolic space and more generally for symmetric spaces. And since I will be mostly focusing on hyperbolic manifolds and especially surfaces, I would like to recall the monochromatic plane waves in the hyperbolic setting. So in the hyperbolic setting, what replaces the standard plane waves are given by these guys. So here I have a slightly different factor here. You will see it later. It's related to the bottom of the continuous spectrum of the Laplacian. So it's just a convention to make things easier. And here I have what replaced the Fourier phase here, which is given by so-called Boosman functions. And the level set of Boosman functions, so the wave fronts, are given by horocycles. Okay? And Xi is living at infinity. It's the direction of propagation of the plane waves. So the pretty familiar picture, and so this is on simply connected spaces, but if you want to carry such an analysis on more complicated manifolds, we will see that it is possible to do it later. So in the Euclidean setting, what you get is pretty much the same picture. These are non-L2 eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. And we have the analog of Fourier transform, which is given by Helgason Fourier analysis. The same picture is valid, except that it is slightly more complicated. And we do have this C function, which is given by some gamma functions in the integrals here. So if we are looking for a general setup where you can mimic this kind of explicit parametrization of the continuous spectrum, the most convenient setting is given by so-called conformally compact manifolds. So it's a setting where you can actually compactify infinity in a smooth way, and then define plane waves. Of course, you cannot do it explicitly, but there is a trick that you can use Instead, you are using the resolvent. So the first step, of course, is to say something about the resolvent. So since I will be working in hyperbolic on hyperbolic manifolds, I'm using this spectral parameter, the usual spectral parameter S times n minus S. So we look at this resolvent as a family of bounded operators on L2, holomorphic family, and then there is a meromorphic continuation after cutting off or putting suitable weights at infinity, which is due to Mazur-Melrose. And once you have this meromorphic continuation outside from the resonances, from the pole, you can analyze the structure of the resolvent, the Schwarz kernel of the resolvent, and we have a precise asymptotic behavior. And the trick to define the plane waves is to look at the restriction on the boundary. So you fix one variable, okay? You fix S, which is not a pole, and you let M prime go to infinity, okay? And of course, you have to renormalize, you have to multiply by the correct factor, which is x of m prime to the power minus s. So x is a defining function, okay, which tells you how close to the boundary you are. And when you do that, then you recover an eigenfunction of the Laplacian. And this eigenfunction depends on the limit point at infinity, which I will call Xi. And so for convenient, to get simple expressions, we have to renormalize it by some gamma factors. It's of course related to this C function you saw before. And you end up with a genuine eigenfunction, which is of course non-L2. And these guys, simply by Stone formula, they do parameterize the continuous spectrum. Okay, so we have an interesting family, an interesting continuous family of eigenfunctions. And they are the natural generalization of plane waves. Okay. So in the simplest setting, how do they look like? Okay, so let's look at surfaces. So we just look at hyperbolic surfaces, convex compact. So these are in this conformally compact setup. These are the simplest examples. And so familiar picture, we uniformize these surfaces by Schottky groups. And as in most previous talk, there will be always this delta notation, which denotes the dimension, the Hausdorff dimension of the limit set. This guy will be here again in that talk, although we are not talking about resonances at all. It will play a role also in that case. Okay, so in this setup, how do they look like? These so-called plane waves. So of course, if you work on the universal cover, you can identify in a natural way the boundary and the discontinuity set of the group, of the action of the group at infinity. So you remove the limit set, and there you have a proper action. And so if you look at this mod gamma, you have a model for your compact boundary, your compactifications. And so if you take a natural boundary defining function and you use this renormalization, you end up with that kind of formal series, which are actually converging whenever the real part of S is bigger than delta, okay? So if you are in this region of absolute convergence, then these guys are exactly the guys I defined through the resolvent trick. And for some obvious reasons, these are called Eisenstein series. So they are not the usual Eisenstein series associated to cusps. These guys are related to funnels. So you have, of course, a continuous choice of points at infinity for each connected component of the boundary, which are parameterized by xi. So xi still is at infinity. And s is the spectral parameter. So you get basically, you recover the Eisenstein series by summing over the group monochromatic plane waves on the universal cover, okay, with still this Boosman function here. Okay, so you just average, you take a sum over the group of plane waves on the hyperbolic plane. And what am I mostly interested in here in that case is when the spectral parameter is on the continuous spectrum, of course, because that gives you an eigenfunction which is associated to real eigenvalue. Okay? So the guys which are actually parametrizing the continuous spectrum. So in the case when the Hausdorff dimension of the limit set is smaller than 1/2, then you can get all this Eisenstein series by a convergence series like that. So there is an actual expression, an actual formula for this guy. Okay, so what we want to do is to try to say something, just like in the compact case, we would like to say something about the nodal structure. So first, of course, we have to take real parts or imaginary parts, which makes sense because the eigenvalue is real. Otherwise, it wouldn't make any sense. And then our standard goal is just to look at what's going on when the frequency is high. So we are looking basically at a semi-classical regime. And so if you want to just have a look at what it looks like, you can definitely do some numerics because you do have some convergence series to compute them. And here is what you get in the case of a two-generator Schottky group, so for a pair of pants or for trousers or whatever you want to call them. This is what it looks like. So you can see the fundamental domain is outside the circles here, the black circles. Okay. So you just have to look at the picture inside the fundamental domain because otherwise it's just simply reflected outside. So it doesn't make any sense to look at what's inside the circle. So what you can see clearly on this picture that at infinity, so xi is all the way up here at xi is equal to I actually. So this is a unit disk model, obviously. And so you can see all cycles at infinity in the vicinity of xi. And then things start to interfere in the convex core, and you see some more complicated nodal structure. Okay. So it's a very mixed picture. Okay, you see clearly a very regular behavior at infinity, where it's almost orocyclic, and then in the compact part of the surface, it really looks like what you get when you look at a genuine L2 eigenfunction, okay? So this is for a pair of points, but actually there is a simpler model, which is a cylinder. So what's going on the cylinder? Well, on the cylinder, it's not so trivial, actually. You know, the cylinder is supposed to be the case where you are able to compute everything. We know where the resonances are. We have some special functions to compute the resolvent and so on. But if you look at Eisenstein series, this is what you get. So xi is here at 2.5. This is a Poincaré upper half plane model, which is more convenient for this kind of computations. For the elementary case, it's much more convenient to work with this guy. And so you still see these Soros cycles at infinity, but you see that at some point they start to interfere, and then you see some islands, some compact nodal domains. And then again, it looks a bit orocyclic on the other side of the cylinder, okay? And still you have homothetical invariance, okay? So they're just, the same picture gets reflected here inside the circle. Okay, so if we increase frequency, it gets, of course, more complicated, but you see more and more compact nodal domains, more and more islands, but still the very same picture at infinity. Here it is a close-up in the compact part because I wanted to focus on the on the more chaotic structure of the eigenfunctions. So here is what you get. So you can actually see some non-simply connected compact nodal domain here. The frequency should be something like lambda is equal to 150 here in this plot. Okay, so before I state some actual results on this Eisenstein series, I think it's important to have in mind what's known for compact manifolds, okay? Because there is a full industry on nodal lines, nodal domains, and so on compact manifolds. And it's important to put things into perspective. So let's have a look at the compact world. And okay, so I take a compact manifold. I take a Riemannian metric, Laplace-Beltrami operator, discrete spectrum, and so on and so forth. So nodal sets are just the zero sets, in case you were wondering. Nodal sets are just the zero sets of eigenfunctions, and nodal domains are the connected components when you remove the nodal set, okay? So actually, it's not the first result of the theory, but it's probably the only result which is optimal, which is due to Donnelly-Fefferman. So Donnelly-Fefferman, you need to assume that the manifold is real analytic, and you are computing the length of nodal domains, nodal lines, nodal sets, I mean. So you look at the D minus one Hausdorff measure of nodal sets. Then in the semi-classical limit, it is comparable to lambda. Okay, so just the inverse of the wavelength. This is a Donnelly-Fefferman result, and the point is extending this to C-infinity case has proven to be extremely hard. So I won't state the result, but the upper bound and the lower bound that people know in the most general case, in the C-infinity category, are very weak. But this is not the subject of my talk. But in case you were wondering, in the C-infinity case, it is much harder. So real analyticity plays a role here. So long for the length of nodal sets. So what about nodal domains? Okay, so the oldest result and probably the pioneering result in this business is due to Courant. So Courant is telling you that as lambda goes to infinity, the number of nodal domains is bigger than 2 and smaller than a constant times lambda square. So lambda square is the eigenvalue, remember. So of course people are wondering if this is if the upper bound is optimal, and it's not true in general. So there are some simple examples on the sphere and on the torus, where the eigenvalue is going to infinity, but you do have just 2 nodal domains. Okay, so this Bogomolny-Schmidt conjecture is not true on the torus or on the sphere, but people tend to believe that for typical eigenfunctions, this should be true, okay? And actually, it has been proved in a random setting. So if you look at random combination of spherical harmonics or random combination of eigenfunction on the flat torus, then you are able to compute the expectation of the number of nodal domains. So this is a result of Nazarov and Sodin for the sphere, and then there was a result by Rudnick and Bourguin on the torus. So on average, the expectation of the number of nodal domains is lambda square. There is even an asymptotic. But in a deterministic setting, there are no better results than that. Probably the best result so far is due to Jung and Zeldich. So I want to state this result because it is a deterministic result. No cheating here. So if you take a compact surface with negative curvature, then if you do have a symmetry, so you have an isometric involution, okay, then for density one subsequence of odd eigenfunction or even eigenfunction with respect to this symmetry, the number of nodal domain is going to infinity. Okay. There are no results so far without this symmetry hypothesis. Okay. Then there is another related result when you look at Sinai billiards. So the symmetry is replaced basically by boundary, but it's a similar trick. Okay, so this is just telling you that the number of the nodal domain is going to infinity, but there is no effective lower bound. And then before that result, actually, there was a bold statement by a number theorist. So GRS stands for Gauche, Reznikov, and guess who? So on the modular surface, if you assume Lindelof hypothesis for all mass EQL functions, so this is a strong statement, a strong assumption, then you do have an effective lower bound for the number of nodal domains. Okay, so it's fairly hard, and you need to look at, of course, it's not compact on the modular surface, so you look, you cut high above, high in the cusp, you just cut, and look what's inside, what below beta, okay, basically. But you need to take beta large enough for some reason. And then there are some other related results by Jung, the very same Jung here. Okay, so that was just a short survey on the compact world. So I was motivated by this recent results of Zeldich and Jung, and just wanted to just have a look and try to say something about our ancient theories, because these are the most natural candidates in a non-compact setting. Resonance states are a bit problematic so far, okay, because there is no canonical way to say what should be a nodal line in that case, because these are complex values. But in that case, we do have a nodal structure, which is very natural. So, okay, so we look, we take a convex compact surface, we assume that the Hausdorff dimension of the limit set is small, and we look at real valued Eisenstein series, and we just denote by n lambda the nodal set, the one I just showed you in the pictures before. So the first remark is that Donnelly-Fefferman is no big deal here. Okay, so if you want to look, so of course you can see from the picture, and it is fairly easy to prove it, that there are infinitely nodal domains. Okay, so you have to restrict to a compact set, otherwise you don't know how to make sense of it. So if you restrict to a compact set, this Donnelly-Fefferman result is no big deal because it is a purely local argument based on analyticity. Okay. So if you look at what's going on in a small ball, it behaves more or less like a polynomial of degree lambda, and then, okay, so that's, so it works, because here it is obviously really analytic. But what we were able to prove with Jacobson is the following statement, which is actually stronger than Donnelly-Fefferman. So we could actually, in principle, recover the naïf Fermat from this kind of statements. So what do? We count the number of intersections of nodal lines with a fixed curve, and we let lambda go to infinity, okay? So you do have your pair of points. You fix a curve, actually it's a geodesic segment here, so just a small segment here, and you look at the number of intersections of the nodal set with this compact curve. And our result is saying that it behaves like lambda, okay? So pretty much like in the Donnelly-Fermat statement, except that it's a lower dimensional counting result, if you want. So in the compact business, the only result so far that I know, which is close to that one, is on the torus by Bourguin and Rudnick. Actually, it's a bit weaker than that, because on the lower bound, they lose some epsilon. Okay. And it's quite funny, because it is very transversal to their result. In Bourguin-Rudnick statement, they need to look at positive curved curves, so away from geodesics. And here it's dual, it's the contrary. We have to look at geodesics. We have to be far away from horocycles. Okay. Just to mention, this is a lower and an upper bound, and the proofs are very different, although, as you will see, they use some similar ingredients. The upper bound is known in a fairly general setting for surfaces. You need a real analyticity for the upper bound. There is no way you can so far prove something without it. So for compact surfaces without hypothesis on the curvature, if the segment here is nice, so nice means that there is an ad hoc condition, which I will not state, then you do have this upper bound as lambda goes to infinity. Okay. No lower bound in the general setting. And then we can use, I will talk about this at the end of the talk, we can use this result to actually count nodal domains in a compact set. So don't be fooled by the statement, as I will explain. The lower bound is a treachery, lower bound is not very relevant, but the upper bound is relevant. So the upper bound is just like current upper bound, except that in that case we have no boundary condition. So we look at things inside a nice compact set, okay, the boundary is piecewise smooth and so on. And we count the number of nodal domains inside this compact set, and current upper bound is like that, C lambda square. Except that you cannot prove it the way current does. Current is just a simple exercise based on the min-max, but you need boundary condition. Here you cannot do that. So it's based on counting the number of intersections with the curve, as you can guess. And then inside, you need to use some Faber-Kran inequalities to end up with that statement. Okay. So a nice application is to count inside the convex core, which is very natural, okay? Because the boundary is precisely given by geodesics. We can still count things for the cylinder. We just need to look at things inside the collar of the closed geodesic, but we do have similar results. Okay, now I just want to give an overview of the proof. There are some very important ingredients here that come basically for free, which are the two first ones. Okay, so to prove this, the first result, the second result is just based on the first one. So to prove the first one, there will be several ingredients, and the first two ones are just given for free in this setup. And so real analyticity, which is, I think, you really need it for upper bounds. For the lower bound, you don't think, I don't think that it is very necessary. It helps a lot at the technical viewpoint. I mean, at the technical level, real analyticity is very helpful even for the lower bound, but I think it's not very necessary. You can do things just with symphinity curves. But for the upper bound, it's very helpful. And I don't know how to do it without real analyticity. And another ingredient, which is quite striking and very easy to prove, and which is all the difference between the compact setting and this setting here, is that on compact set, these eigenfunctions are L-infinity bounded. They are bounded on every compact set, which is something that you do not have on compact manifolds, far from that. And this is very helpful, and this is probably one of the main reasons that we are able to prove the optimal lower bound. Okay. So these first two facts are very easy, and then we are using that and two results. The first one is a QER type result, so an equidistribution result when you restrict eigenfunctions to curves. In that case, basically geodesics. I mean, it works for fairly general curves. I will try to explain that. Real analytic is just to help us at the technical level. But for the equidistribution, it's not so important. And we combine this with an asymptotic estimate of the average on a curve. Okay. So the first and most important result, ingredient, I will say, which is also a result in itself, is this equidistribution result. I will try to spend a bit of time on that. So what is it about? So you take a piece of real analytic curve on your surface. You restrict your eigenfunction on this curve, and you just integrate it against the test function. You integrate the square against the test function, and you look at what's going on when lambda is going to infinity. And the point is that for almost all directions at infinity, okay, so you fix a curve, then for almost all directions at infinity, as lambda goes to infinity, these integrals are converging to some fairly explicit limit measure. So you do get some kind of equidistribution with respect to a harmonic measure on the curve. So of course, you really need an assumption on a non-symmetry assumption on the eigenfunctions or on the curve, if you want. Okay, because there could be some situation where there are no limits. Okay, there is exactly the same problem when you are on a compact manifold. Okay, basically, an eigenfunction could be vanishing identically on a curve. Okay, so you have to rule out these symmetric cases. And a convenient way to do that for us is just not to move the curve, but to move the point at infinity. Okay, which is much easier to do. But still, we could fix a point at infinity and prove something using some transversality argument for generic curves. Okay, you could work it the other way around, but it's much less natural and probably more difficult. So this is a restriction version of a previous result we had with Colin-Guillermo on Eisenstein series. So we had the result not for the restriction, but just for the average against the test function. Or you could also get a statement using a pseudo-differential operator, just like in the quantum ergodicity statement. So this restriction results in the compact setting. They are due to Toth and Zeldich, and then there is another version by Dyatlov and Zworski. But just, I think it is fair. I mean, we have to be fair to these guys. We have to say that here the mechanism of equidistribution is not due to ergodicity. This is very different. It's due to the propagation to infinity. Okay, so it doesn't work exactly the same way. And this is why also we get stronger statement, because here it is a kind of unique ergodicity statement. Okay, you don't need to extract a subsequence or a zero measure set of this frequencies lambda. It works for a full sequence lambda. So of course here the assumption on the Hausdorff dimension of the limit set is very important. Okay, I'm assuming that delta is smaller than 1/2. So once we do have this equidistribution result, we combine it with another result, which is used for the lower bound, which is the following. So instead of looking at the square of the eigenfunction and testing it against a test function, whatever, we just look at the average of the eigenfunction on a geodesic segment. And the result we have is that away from a Cantor set inside this segment, the decay of the average is like 1 over lambda. Okay? So there is a Cantor set of critical points. And if you are outside this Cantor set, so you can definitely pick a segment outside this Cantor set. Then when you look at the average on this good segment, it decays like 1 over lambda. Of course, you cannot do better than that. You just can integrate by part once. And of course, there are some boundary effects. Okay? Otherwise, you would contradict Donnelly-Fefferman statement, so, or current upper bound. So we use this result combined with L-infinity boundedness in a very trivial way, of course, since it is L-infinity bounded, and since you have equidistribution on equidistribution on curve, then you get a lower bound for the L1 norm. Okay, you get that on a good curve, as lambda goes to infinity, you do have a uniform lower bound for the L1 norm. But on the other hand, you know that this average is decaying. So there is a very elementary lemma that tells you that if you have both uniform lower bound for the L1 norm plus the decay with this rate 1 over lambda, then you do have at least lambda sign changes for the eigenfunction on the curve. And that is how you get the lower bound. Okay, so it's a purely elementary proof. And here you actually don't need real analyticity at all. Okay? And for the upper bound, here you need real analyticity. And how does it work at the technical level? It's quite simple also. You just need to complexify the curve. So you restrict the eigenfunction to the curve. It is real analytic. So it has definitely a holomorphic extension to a complex neighborhood or a Grauer tube or whatever you want to call it, which is uniform. Of course, the size is uniform in lambda. And you do have this standard upper bound for the growth of the L-infinity norm of the eigenfunction on the complexified neighborhood. It grows like constant times e to constant lambda. So there is an exponential blow up, which you cannot avoid, of course. And then what you do to count the number of intersections of nodal sets with your line here, you just look at the extension, holomorphic extension. You have a holomorphic function, and you just want to count its zeros. Okay, so what you are going to do is just to use Jensen's formula. So this upper bound is obviously giving you the upper bound in the end, but you need another ingredient to be able to apply Jensen's formula. You need a lower bound at some point. And this is where you will use the lower bound for the L1 norm, because it gives you some pointwise control at some suitable points, and you just apply Jensen's formula in the end, and you get the upper bound. Okay. So that's in a nutshell how it works. Okay. And now a series of comments about nodal domains. Okay. So using this result, which is counting the number of intersections of nodal lines with a given curve, you can produce an upper bound for the number of nodal domains inside a compact region. And what you see, obviously, that the one who lies at the boundary, okay, are contributing to at most big O of lambda. Okay, so the one who could, in principle, saturate the current bound are the compact ones, the small islands. Okay, so I showed you that a few slides before. I showed you a lower bound, and I told you that it was a kind of trickery. So let me show why it is a trickery. So a lower bound is telling you that when you look at the number of nodal domains inside a compact region, a nice compact region, it grows at least like lambda. So of course it is far from the lambda square, but it is even weaker than that, because you are just counting nodal domain from the inside point of view. So you could definitely have a wiggly nodal domain like that. Okay. We should do something like that. No. Okay, so you can figure it out. I don't need to draw what's outside. Okay, so from the inside viewpoint, you see at least two or three nodal domains, or maybe more. But actually, there is only one single nodal domain which is contributing to that bound. Okay, and this is the main reason why Bourguin and Runic are not able to get a lower bound for the number of nodal domains on the torus, for the very same reason. Okay, so this lower bound is not very relevant. What is truly relevant is to count compact nodal domains. And there seem, at least on the numerical level, there seem to be a lot of them, even in the case of the hyperbolic cylinder. Okay, on the hyperbolic cylinder, you see plenty of compact nodal domains, as I showed a while before. So you see them even on the trivial case. But I don't know actually how to prove that they do exist. Okay, I can bound them in a collar of the closed geodesic. I can say that there are at most lambda square of them using this result on the counting the number of intersections with the given curve. I can definitely bound them. I can also produce a fake lower bound in the very same way, but I don't know how to show that they do exist. And even more striking than that, I don't know yet how to show that they are not going to infinity. Okay, so you look at compact nodal domains, you see that most of them seem to lie fairly close to the closed geodesic, which is what you would expect, you know. You would expect that most interferences, these guys are created by interferences, okay, And most interferences should occur in a color of the closed geodesic, but still you can see some of them which are pretty far away, and there is actually one of them here. So a very first question is try to show that there are only, for a lambda fixed, of course, there are only finitely many of them, that they do not escape to infinity. I don't know how to do that. So this is the first, I think, relevant question. So of course, in the vicinity of Xi, you can prove whatever you want, because you can actually prove that it is fairly close to Eurocycles. Okay. And of course, the ultimate question is to try to prove the Bogomolny-Schmidt conjecture or to say something about compact nodal domains. But as I said, even on the torus, it's not known. So it is probably a difficult question. And I will probably end here just by this picture, which is again a close-up at high frequency, where you can see actually all these compact guys in between non-compact ones. Okay, so thank you.
Okay, any question, comments? So everything is recorded here. No question? As long as you say something nice, I think it's fine. Ma Jack, you don't have any comments? No comments. Okay, so I just have a curious question. So how about, you only look at the real part, how about imaginary part, the same result?
The same picture, the same result, it doesn't make any difference.
And also, how about you add some cuspidal eigenfunction? Oh, here you don't have a cuspidal.
No, I don't have cusp here.
Okay.
This is another problem.
So how about the...
So we could try to look at the Eisenstein series related to cusp.
Yes.
On a geometrically finite surface. That is another question.
Okay.
And you should be able to plot the nodal lines too, probably. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's thank the speaker again, and now we go for lunch.